originally from Sierra Leone. I was born in Sierra Leone, Koidota, but my parents are from the Gambia. I went to school in Sierra Leone. I did everything in Sierra Leone. It's a country I love. I left Sierra Leone when I was 27. That was 1997. I was still young, I was still strong, active. Well, nothing planned, when I came to Guinea, I met somebody who was a businessman who said, I know him personally, he said, well, I think the war in Sierra Leone is gonna extend, it's gonna grow. So if you have some money, I will help you to get visa. Mm-hmm. And we come to fast together, because he was a businessman who traveled every time. So just ask for a few amount of money, like to get me a visa, then we can come. It was not my dream to come to France. It was not my plan to come to France. It just happened. So when I came to France, I was a refugee. And before then, I didn't speak no French. It's when I came to, when I came to France, I started learning French. I started to integrate myself to the French society, started to go out meeting friends, and start to understand the French culture. I was living in a homeless home because I didn't know nobody there at that time. So because they're a home for people where you can go and sleep at night. In the morning, you have to go out. So there I was doing for many, many months before I start meeting people. So they start telling me you don't have to sleep at that place. But when I came as a refugee, so you need to go through the refugee process, so it takes a long time. Start following my refugee status. My status was stated for many, many more years, for 2 years roughly, until I met my French wife. But when I told her, well, I'm still a refugee from Sierra Leone, she said, well, I don't care. I just want to be with you. I just wanted to say, if you want to stay with me, then we can live together. So that's how we decided to live together, and we get married, and I start working legally. I never decided to leave France. I just was very nice, comfortable in France. It's just like I have a friend that was in Austria when my business was not working for me anymore. He just told me, well, there's a good business going on here. Like people are going to the villages, getting old cars to send to Africa, and you move a lot. So if you can come to Graz, I can show you the way to get these cars from the villages and take them to Africa. That's why I came here. Okay. But it was not my plan to come and live in Graz. Yeah, I love integration. I love when I go to any country or wherever I go, I like to meet the people there. To be part of the people, be part of the society, then go out, talk to people that are French people or whatsoever, to be part of a society.
How did you get to Graz? In train, in bus? How did you?
On train. I took the train, yeah. I took the train from Gardino, from Gardiles, yeah. Mm. That's where I took it from.
Did you have a lot of luggage?
No, I have only one small hand luggage, only one.
Was ist Ihre Meinung zu Ausländern in Graz?
Zu viel haben wir da.
Ostern in Graz.
Ausländern.
Ausländer in Graz.
Ja.
Danke.
Wir brauchen
das. Danke. Danke.
Wir sollen gehen, wo sie herkommen.
Wir wohnen leider in so einem Haus, wo jede größere Wohnung, was frei wird, eben besetzt wird von Ausländern.
Wir haben schon viel gestohlen. Und dann habe ich schon ein bisschen Abneigung.
Ich bin mit dem Bus gefahren nach Gösting und dann ist der Ausländer da, ich stecke Ausländer, so trage ich nicht.
Ja, das habe ich ganz, ganz, ganz schlimm gefunden.
And what was your first impression when you arrived to Graz for this new life, for this new start?
Well, I cannot tell more because I came just 2 days after when I went to prison.
2 days?
Yes, spent 2 days here, I went to prison. I came around on the 11th and I went to prison on the 13th. So like 2 days only in Graz. So I have no experience to tell anyone about Graz. So I didn't see the town much. I just went maybe to the internet cafe. I went there, but I didn't see much in Graz. I cannot tell much that time. I was in the flat sitting there when the police just came in and just hit the door and tell everybody it's a police eye, nobody should move. So then I was arrested with four people there, yeah, three people, sorry. We were sitting just watching TV and the police just came and we were all arrested at that time.
And what did the police tell you?
Yeah, they said we are drug dealers.
Drug dealers?
Yes.
And what did you say?
I said, no, I'm not drug dealers. I said, yes, we are drug dealers. Just two days in Austria, then I was a lot. That's not, I cannot speak nothing in German at that time. When I felt that, you know, I'm going to go out tomorrow, the same night, I was saying, well, it's not me. They're talking about drug, but drug is not my way. So I was really confident I'm going out the next day or the same day. Yes, I believe if they were doing it or they are part of it, I have no idea. Just like, for me, I would say, I'm going to go out. Well, I was not worried, you know, because I knew what I'm doing, I knew what I've done, I knew what is drugs, so I was nothing worried about when the police arrested me. Just maybe I was at the wrong place, at the wrong time, that's what happened. But to say I'm going to go for being imprisoned for drug, no, I was not worried. That came on my mind, I'm going to go out. After they questioned me, then they took me back to the prison, they brought me, questioned me again, then from there they have to transfer me to Giacomini. So Giacomini, then they say I have to wait 2 weeks to see the judge.
2 weeks?
Then, yeah, I wait 2 weeks to see the judge. The judge say, well, the police say you're a drug dealer, they believe you came from France, you brought something here, then we're going to keep you again for another two months. So 2 months continue, 2 months. Another two months continue.
And did you have the right to call your family and inform them?
And I was not given no right for 9 months, nothing. No, absolutely zero. They didn't allow me to talk to nobody at that time. But the discrimination didn't come on my mind. It came very late. The time it started coming on my mind, when they start talking about voices, they start telling me things I didn't do. I don't know whether it's justice system. They start telling me they got my voice. They start telling me I bought 1 kilo of cocaine from France. They start telling me, well, you're going to stay here for long. You are a drug dealer because you work with these people. But things start going that I start feeling this is not justice anymore. For me, it's not a justice because they caught nothing with me. They didn't see anything with me. There was no proof. There was no evidence. None of these guys said this guy is a drug dealer. I'm clean. But then they were insisting, yes, I'm the boss.
You're the boss.
I'm the one that organized everything. I'm the one that gave them drugs to sell. So I was giving all the accusation on me. So then I was just, okay, I have to wait. But I was start feeling very angry. I cannot have patience. But I start feeling there's something wrong. This is not more about justice. It's about maybe they try to discriminate me now. Because keeping someone with no proof, no evidence, nothing absolutely, for me it was not a good sign. Well, they gave me the government lawyer, which represented me, which is Magister Pechner, which used to come and see me, telling me it's a justice system. You have to be patient. Then after that one, I started writing to Amnesty International. I wrote later to Human Rights in Strasbourg. They replied me, they said, well, I think Austria have their own system of justice. You have to be patient and wait until they finish everything. If they finish and you are not found guilty, we're going to take over. But I wrote to all this Amnesty International, I wrote to European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg, that's what I want. Because I find myself now a victim of discrimination. So they start keeping me along for 1 year, 1 year, 2 months, 1 year, 4 months, 1 year, 6 months. There was still no proof. We start keeping a person, telling him, yes, you did it. We know you did it. We're going to find something against you. That's all they always tell me.
The police told you, yes. Also the other prisoners.
They say, you know you did it. The prisoners told you, yeah, Fatty, we know you did it. Just say the truth and go out. We know they're going to find something against you.
And what else did they tell you? If you say you are guilty, what?
Well, they say if I say I'm guilty, they'll give me a small sentence, a few sentences, like a few years and go. But if they find something against me, it's going to be like 10 to 15 years in prison. But I said, well, I prefer to go for 10 for 15 years because I didn't do nothing. I never worry, I never scared. I know my time is going to waste. It's going to last long, but I will come out one day. I never get worried because I was confident I didn't do nothing. So I just left everything in the hands of God. I was just praying to God every day to judge between me and the justice. Mm-hmm. Because I believe that God is there and is seeing the right thing. God knows what I've done. So I was just, with my faith, I just leave everything in the hands of God. God sees judge between me and them. Because you know everything, you see everything. Because we believe in God that God sees everything, he knows everything. That's okay, God judge between me and the justice. And find out that I got the justice. I said to my lawyer, I have a problem here. I'm not going to go back. I'm going to stay here. I decided to stay here and to look for a job. But then I was given permission to go back to France and follow my case. But I don't want to go back to France because I lost everything there. I had to go start fresh. Now I decided to stay in Austria to start looking for a job, start a new life, but it was very difficult. I went to two or three places in a restaurant to wash plates. They say, well, you cannot speak Dutch, so we cannot give you the job. So I got a job at where the wash cars and all these things. I went there for a week because the guy said, well, I don't think you cannot speak better jobs. I cannot take you because you cannot speak Dutch. So because of that, I would just spend only 1 week at the working place. When you walk in the street before you go back home, at least me personally, people say, oh, Swaz Africa, Bas Max to here, get my internet line. This was a big, very insulting to me. Very, very insulting, it's very provocative.
And
I was very
young people, old people?
And mostly are old people. Most of the time of 90s, old people doing that, old women, old men, they say, oh, Swaz Africa. The worst time was, I came from Caritas that morning, I went to the park just to relax, when an old woman comes with her dog. I was lying on the bench, just nice, hey, that's my story, yeah, it's for Hunte.
That's for dogs?
Yeah, it's for dogs. So that's, she said, yeah, for dogs. I was very angry, and I responded to her, telling her everything. And she says she's going to call the police. And I said, well, you can call the police if you want. You can't tell me here for dog. I'm just sitting in line, you telling me here for dogs that morning. I was very angry, so. But you know, sometimes the word is a big word. I don't want to use it, but I can see, she can't do that to an Austrian man. When I was in prison, after I said, but Austria, especially Graz, the people are like Hitlers. People say that, they say, because Hitler is from here, the people are not good. Well, I reply to them, not everyone is bad. I'm not worried about people. I just say, well, you always meet good people and bad people. No matter where you come from, whether you're black or white, you're always bad. If they are bad, maybe one person is bad among 10 people. So I cannot judge one because of 10. Always you're going to find nice people. People start telling me you have to be careful. Austria is different from France, different from UK. And I say, yes. But you can never tell one bad to all. So I don't want to say, oh, I was in Austria, she did to me, I have to pay back. I have to revenge. Never will I allow anybody to do such things because it's not part of our system. Now, people is to welcome people. Imagine people going to Africa, the way they were welcome. No matter how they are bad, nobody care. Everybody giving them smile. Big smile. So I don't think if that person go to us, that Austrian woman go to in Sierra Leone, wherever, and I say, oh, this was a woman who did that to me, nobody's going to revenge. I don't believe in revenging. She's going to be welcome to it. But that we teach her, when she comes back, she will change. You know, if you revenge, you make people bad again. People get bad and bad when you revenge. But when you show people, no, don't worry about that, they change. They're human beings. They will change their way. They say, oh, I'm ashamed. This guy, I push him in Austria, but now they welcome me here. People are still victims of discrimination, still. We have them everywhere, but I think for Austrians, it's still a long way to go. Where people feel it, people know, people understand. But in France, you don't feel it much. It's there, but you don't feel it because the society is accepting it. If you go to UK, the society is accepting it. But Austria, the society is not accepting it yet. You don't belong here, you don't belong to this society, you have to go where you belong to. And this is what we try to fight against. That we all the same people, no matter how you are white or black, we're the same people. We all have a value as a human being. I'm a human being, and you're a human being. That's all we have a value. That's what I believe. Yeah, we need people to intervene, need people to tell people, no, stop it. Tell people, don't be scared, don't worry, tell them, no, stop these people, stop saying that to the people. We are all one. If you really positive, you're really fighting against discrimination, you hear such things people are saying to other people, you should stand and stop it. Tell them to stop. But we are no more in that those days. We are now in new generation where. Definitely, I would like people like your type or anybody who is against discrimination to say that to other people, to stop saying that to people. After 18 months, I won justice. Then the judge told me, you ask for compensation. Then we start asking with my lawyer for damages, because it's not only, because the minimum, like the time I spend in prison, is 100 a day. That's the government law, that's the law. Yeah. At least I should got about 48,000, that's the minimum shipping. So my mother said, no, it caused a lot of damages on you that they have to pay. You lost everything in France, you lost everything there, you lost, they have to pay a lot of damages in your life. This is your freedom, this is everything about you. This is the minimum, whether we go to court or not, they're gonna give it to you. Say, okay, let's start with 218,000 to ask. But you're not going to have that one. Maybe you expect to have 100,000, 150,000. But not at all. The worst, it's my compensation. I got less than that. Yeah. If you want to know the amount, I can tell you I got less than that. So I was supposed to have more, like I spent 488 days. Like it's about 48,000. So they gave me less than that, which is not fair. That is not fair. That is a big, big discrimination. I would say, why they did it to me? Why? Because I'm not an Austrian or I'm not from here? Because the minimum is not me, it's not my law, it's the law of the government that we have to give him the money. The judge said, go ask for your compensation. He's a justice man, he knows the law. Say, go and ask for your compensation. They're going to give it to you. So why didn't they give me my right? I won it. I clear my name to get my compensation, to start my new life. They refuse to give everything to me. And that is a big discrimination, like I always say. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why I decided finally to go from Austria. In London, I'm comfortable there, yeah, because I don't, at this moment, find any discrimination in the street, at work, nowhere. Maybe they have it on their mind, but they cannot show it out, they cannot take any action or whatever. Mm. Yeah.
And
yeah.
In London it was easier to find a job?
Yeah, very, very easy indeed. Because when I went to London to look for a job, I got it within a week. So I got it immediately, I was employed full time. So I got it, yes, I was so lucky. It's a lucky then, it's not, it's a lucky and to get a job, a full-time job within a week, and that's the job I'm doing at this moment. I'm a bicycle mechanic now. And we make the bicycle, that Evans cycle where I walk and so I work.
Immigration.
And it's a struggle. Diversity that jumped that one. It doesn't count, it doesn't matter. Worries. Not a place. Not accepted. The best thing. Best way forward. The positive man. Always. The value you have. My value I still have, like I'm still happy that I got my freedom. I do my things on my own and I can express myself, and I can send a message to people like what I'm doing now. This is a big value for me now, because this is a big value. I can say, wow, my freedom was seized. I'm out, I'm a free man, and I can tell we all need freedom. We all need to be part of a society. The freedom is my force, something I was fighting for when I came to Europe. Okay. I want to free, move around, be with people.
Tell us about the soul of Fati.
Well, I didn't suffer a lot. I got a lot of experience, a lot. Fati got a lot of experience that I want to send to the people, to the world, that we should be courageous, we should live one, should have faith, and not never try to revenge. And focus and positive always. That's me. I never get discouraged. I always focus, and always confidence is gonna change. Always me is gonna change. It's a long process. That's me. No matter what you do to me, you're gonna change. The situation is gonna change to the way you want it. But you must remain focused. That's me. I'm always remain focused and positive. Always. That's me. And I'm gonna work with people at all time you need me. I'll be here.